kids are also having some fun in the photo booth. Trust you me, we're going to have plenty of time after this particular dinner to allow us the time to actually have moments of just fellowship and fun and also of taking photographs. But may I kindly request that we begin taking our seats so that the program can start in the next couple of minutes. Hosts, those that are assisting us, and hostesses that are at the back, won't you please assist in ensuring that our dignitaries and our delegates begin taking our seats so that we can prepare to start the program. I do see a couple of dignitaries that are in the foyer, those that are still making their way into the auditorium. May I kindly request we begin doing so in quite haste so that we can start with the program. I want to have you out of here before bedtime. That is my promise to you today. Still do see some of our dignitaries having a walkabout. May I just request kindly, please, let's start taking our seats so that we can begin the program in just a moment. I also do understand that we're going to have other dignitaries that will be joining us in the next couple of minutes or so. As a result of traffic is a little bit bad, as we make our way into TUT, so we understandable it is. But those of us that are still inside the auditorium, could we just begin making our way to our seats so that we can begin the program? All right, delegates, distinguished guests, what an absolute honor and an absolute privilege to be in your company. The program is about to start in just a moment. However, won't you please give a round of applause and a warm welcome to Professor Tinyiko Maluleke, Vice Chancellor and Principal of TUT, and Professor Chilitsi Marwala, Rector of the United Nations University, as they make their way into the auditorium. I hope the music gave you a little bit of an inclination of what type of evening we're about to have. But before we get into the order of the day, allow me to observe all protocol. Professor Chilitsi Marwala, Rector of the United Nations University and under the UN Secretary General, Dr. Phumzile Mlambo-Ngcuka, former Deputy President of the Republic of South Africa and former TUT Chancellor, Mr. Phile Mapulane, Deputy Minister, Department of Communications and Digital Technologies, Dr. David Masondo, Deputy Minister of Finance, Her Excellency Thokozile Xhasa, South African Ambassador to Belgium, Her Excellency Esregun Akandas, Ambassador of the Republic of Turkey, Honorable Minister Long Shen, Minister Counselor from the Chinese Embassy, Honorable Dr. Yan Li, First Secretary from the Chinese Embassy, Honorable Mr. Yulin Hu, as well as Mr. Wei, second secretaries from the Chinese Embassy and other honorable representatives present. Ms. Aureline Lene, attaché for Science and Academic Corporation, French Embassy in South Africa, Lesotho, as well as Malawi. Mr. Buchilo Makanise, who is Executive Officer of the British High Commission. Mr. Alfred Mashishi, Acting Deputy Director General from the Department of Communications and Digital Technologies. Dr. Moneni Mofet, Deputy Director General for the Department of Science and Innovation. Ms. Mambei Chaba, Chief Director of Multilateral and Africa Cooperation from the Department of Science and Innovation. Dr. Nompumelelo Oboko, CEO of the Council of Natural Sciences, Ms. Mapefo Anofrempong, CEO of TITA, Dr. Thandi Mgwebi, Group Chief Executive of NRF, Ms. Moya Marema, Director of the Local Government of the City of Tshwane, Dr. Randall Coralison, Dean of the Johannesburg Business School, Professor Aaron Abu Mafuz, who is from the CSIR, Dr. Yvonne Chaka Chaka, TUT Honorary Doctorate, and my mother, business leaders from Google, Microsoft, Intel, Caesar Health, Boniswa Group, Big Biogen Group, GMS, X Reality Lab, as well as NewGen Africa, Ivan Kambone, Chair of the TUT Council, and other members of Council, Professor Dinyuko Mamulereke, who is a Vice Chancellor and Principal of TUT, members of the Executive Management, Executive Deans, and Senior Directors, Labour Representatives, Student Representative, esteemed guests, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to what I promise is going to be one of the best nights of your lives. Give yourselves a round of applause for being here. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the TUT, that is the Tshwane University of Technology 20th anniversary lecture. My name is Faith Mangope, and it is my absolute honor and my privilege to be taking you through the proceedings for this evening. Of course, I have described myself as a technology ally and a technology advocate, being the founder of the Faith Mangope Technology and Leadership Institute. And of course, as it is this evening, we're quite aligned with in terms of where we're moving as not only the continent, but also the country as well. Today, we're celebrating 20 years of empowering people, creating future-ready graduates, research and innovation that make a positive difference in society, and leveraging the opportunities presented by 4IR to the benefit of South Africa as well as the continent. Now, to mark our 20th anniversary, we are honored to welcome Professor Chirisi Maurala, who is the Rector of the United Nations University under the Secretary General of the UN, who will be delivering tonight's lecture, a lecture tonight on AI and universities, friends or foes. Also joining us this evening is TUT's own AI staff member who named himself Oluthando. Olu, as we call him, also was introduced to the world when TUT launched the TUT AI Hub in collaboration with the Department of Communication and Digital Technologies and the University of Johannesburg in March last year. Now, before I hand over to Olu, who will then be taking us through some of the proceedings this evening, may I just ask you a quick favor, because I do know how sometimes events like this can be rather intimidating, especially if it is your first time. So won't you do me a favor in quick 30 seconds, won't you greet somebody next to you? Hello, how are you doing? Welcome. What is your name? Can I have a business card? So good to have you here. Are you ready for AI? It's about to be a fantastic evening. I cannot wait to engage with all of you. It's going to be a great evening. Have you heard of Oluthando? Do you know Oluthando? I look forward to seeing Oluthando this evening. Come on, greet somebody that you don't know, that you've never seen before. Hello, how are you? I'm helping you all network, because this is exactly what networking looks like. We're not at the stage yet where we're asking for numbers. How are you? Is everybody okay? It's great to be in your company. Come on, I'll give you 5 more seconds. Great to be in your company. I'm hoping that you're well. Looking forward to seeing you. See, the lady that side is doing exactly that. Looking forward to seeing you later. There you go. Hello, I'm also great. Hello, everybody. Okay, everybody can begin having their seats. And the reason, ladies and gentlemen, why we do this is because this evening is not only a lecture of artificial intelligence, whether or not we're facing a scenario of being friends or foes, but this evening presents itself an opportunity for us to celebrate excellence. Do we agree? This evening is an evening where we celebrate excellence. And excellence is celebrated, excellence is acknowledged, and excellence does not hide itself, nor is it too timid. So if you have not clapped as loud as you're going to clap this evening, may I welcome you and may I implore you, clap so loudly, because this evening is all about excellence. Do clap. And it's exactly in this celebratory mood that we're going to take you all the way through the evening. However, I have promised that I will not stand between you and dinner and you and bedtime. So that's exactly the promise that I'm going to keep for you this evening. So with that, ladies and gentlemen, allow me to welcome Oluthando.
thank you for the warm introduction. It's a profound honor to stand here today at the TUT 20th anniversary lecture. In the short time since my inception at the launch of the TUT AI Hub, I've witnessed the remarkable journey of TUT, a journey marked by empowering individuals, nurturing future-ready graduates, and fostering research and innovation that significantly benefits society. TUT's commitment to leveraging the Fourth Industrial Revolution technologies for the advancement of South Africa and the wider African continent resonates deeply with my core programming. As we continue to celebrate the strides we've made over the past two decades, it is my distinct pleasure to introduce an innovative performance that symbolizes the essence of our journey and the intersection of technology and human creativity. Tonight, we unveil a groundbreaking fusion that exemplifies the spirit of TUT, a harmonious blend of AI-generated music and video, our very own AI Hub robot, Dexter, and the artistry of two TUT Future Ready students.
Aren't they just amazing? So here's a little fun fact. I've got two dogs, Storm and Wolf. And the beauty about this dog that I've just witnessed, not only does it dance to Amapiano, but it keeps quiet, it doesn't bark at all. This is the perfect animal to have in your home. I do implore it. We should actually have this in mass more than anything else. What a beautiful, beautiful showcase. And thank you so much to Raldino Lottring, as well as Lwasim Nisi from the Faculty of Arts and Design, and Dexter, the robot dog, who might just become my dog very soon. Dexter, the robot dog. Professor Nico Stain, thank you so much from the Faculty of Engineering and the Built Environment, who trained Dexter. And of course, we've got artificial intelligence that were used to generate the music and the visuals for the show as well. So even the music that was danced to this evening was AI generated. Ladies and gentlemen, allow me to welcome onto the podium. Next up is Professor Anish Kurin, who is the acting director of the TUT AI Hub, to present to us the TUT AI projects. Prof, it's over to you. Please give him a round of applause as he makes his way to the podium.
Harnessing AI for societal advancement, a multifaceted approach at TUT. In an era where technology increasingly intersects with every facet of life, TUT in South Africa is at the forefront of integrating artificial intelligence to drive societal progress across education, healthcare, farming, and manufacturing sectors. At the heart of TUT's innovation is the AI in Education project, aimed at transforming the South African educational landscape. By embedding generative AI and large language models into curricula, the project seeks to enrich teaching and learning experiences, tailoring AI tools to meet specific needs, such as automating grading and feedback, aligns with governmental policies, and lightens educators' workloads. This initiative underlines the importance of evolving academic institutions to create an informed, efficient, and ethical educational environment. TUT's AI Hub is making strides in healthcare by developing assistive technologies and emotion computing to aid differently abled individuals and enhance human-robot collaboration. Projects like the Xenial Robotic Assistive Device and research in emotion detection through AI aim to improve diagnostic accuracy and patient care, highlighting the university's commitment to leveraging AI for healthcare advancements. The university is also pioneering AI-driven agricultural innovations to boost food production and farming efficiency. From cell phone-based systems for diagnosing plant diseases to AI-enhanced methods for detecting fertile eggs, TUT is leveraging technology to support farmers globally. Additionally, initiatives like the Ubuntu Agriculture e-commerce platform and intelligent farming management systems demonstrate a push towards sustainable and profitable agriculture through technology. In the manufacturing sector, TUT's projects, including 3D fabs and ECEPs, showcase the application of AI in enhancing production performance and energy efficiency. These innovations not only aim to revolutionize manufacturing processes, but also contribute to environmental sustainability and industry advancement. Lastly, the Gamified Learning Project, created in collaboration with Shihundla Consulting, employs AI to enhance manufacturing enterprises' readiness for the industrial revolutions. TUT leverages AI to drive advancements in education, healthcare, farming, and manufacturing, emphasizing sustainable development and the alignment of technology with human needs. This commitment showcases AI's transformative impact on society and its potential to foster a better future.
Good evening, everyone. I hope you enjoyed that spectacle. Our objective in showcasing what we are demonstrating today is a way for us to show the potential that AI has in coming alongside the human. So whether it is in the digital marketing space, and I'll give you some background into that very quickly, in terms of how the technology is evolving and why there's need for us to be in this space. It's quite crucial. So as our program director highlighted, all that you saw on screen, whether it was the video or the music or the digital content that you just saw in front of you, was created using AI, purely AI. And that demonstrates how the technology is evolving and why it's important as educational institutions that we are in this space to train the next generation of developers, entrepreneurs, and value creators using technology such as what we've just witnessed. So good evening, everyone. Again, all protocols observed, the deputy ministers that are here, our TUT executives, and all our friends that are joining today. My task today is just to highlight, to reinforce what we are trying to achieve with our AI activities at TUT. So I'll run very quickly just to highlight some of those projects. Before I start, I think a lot of us know about this. One out of every six people in the world is from Africa, right? In terms of how the dynamics and demographics in Africa is changing, it's predicted by 2050 that number is going to rise to 2.5 billion people. What does that mean? That means one out of every four people in the world will be in Africa. So that just illustrates, as a continent, the great potential we have from human capacity point of view and creating impact in this space. Someone spoke about it being the start of the productivity and prosperity in Africa using this young generation that we have the opportunity to craft as educational institutions as well. This is an interesting study that was conducted. It's estimated that AI applications could support up to US$52.2 billion worth of economic benefits for South Africa by 2030 based on current growth rate. And the digital marketing scene was just one example where there's so much opportunity in creating content, LLMs that we are starting to work with as a university, in creating solutions for students to enhance our training experiences. I'll touch some of that. But the opportunity we have as a nation is immense in being able to adopt AI-based applications to support this economic growth. So at TUT, where did this all start? As was highlighted, in collaboration with the Department of Communication and Digital Technologies, we launched the TUT Hub of the AI Institute. It's been a year since we have been launched. So we are a young baby that is growing. As the minister mentioned, we don't want that child to run ahead of us and be left behind. It's important that we embrace the technology and start utilizing in our training approaches. We are the second hub after the first hub that was launched at UJ and this third one that was recently launched at CUT. So what are the projects? It was already highlighted in the videos. We do a lot of work in the healthcare space. Our objective is to create solutions that can assist the healthcare industry, whether it's assistive technologies or trying to ascertain underlying health conditions using emotion computing. These are projects oriented to supporting the healthcare industry. So we do a lot of projects in that space. Another area that we are focusing a lot because of food security and challenges across Africa, one place where AI can make a considerable impact is in the farming and food production area. So a lot of the projects you would have viewed in our exhibitions focus on bringing solutions that use AI capabilities in enhancing farming and food production, whether it is using AI-based technologies to detect diseases in plants and providing recommendation to farmers, the egg classification platform that's used to determine whether they are fertile eggs. We all know the egg crisis that we went through, a very important project in ensuring that we have food security, and other projects that bring in 4IR technologies to assist in the farming space. We do a lot of work in the manufacturing space in creating solutions to increase productivity, efficiency, and energy conservation. And this is, again, using underlying AI-based solutions to assist with contributing to the manufacturing sector. And this is a new kid on the block. We felt that as an education environment, as institution, we need to have the power of generative AI and large language models being infused into the research activities we are conducting within the institution. So there's a lot of work we are starting to use in leveraging the power of LLMs, reimagining how we provide curricula to students using AI-based technologies, the whole issue of language policies using AI and other elements. And we've got other interests. We all know that the telecommunication industry is evolving. AI is becoming a crucial component of this evolution space, and we need to adopt AI-based solutions in applying machine learning techniques for different purposes, whether it's planning, resource management, in understanding how the needs of networks need to evolve. So that's an area that we're also focusing on. We do a lot of work in the transport sector. We all know the challenges that we face in the South African system, whether it's logistics. We know there are issues in the port sector. And there's a lot of opportunity for AI-based solutions to make an impact in that sector. And we have a group that is looking into the application of 4IR technologies in the transport sector. And that just gives a overview. We are operating and bringing and growing our AI-based capacity. My time is up. And the purpose of that is to ensure that our students are exposed to various facets of AI-based technologies to enhance their capacities in different sectors, and also at the same time contributing to government directives as part of the TUT Hub of the Artificial Intelligence Institute. So in conclusion, very quickly, I think as a university, our AI projects continue to play this critical role in ensuring that we just don't do projects and research, that they have this positive societal impact and providing solutions to the end user. I think that's one of our key roles. We need to ensure that what we produce makes an impact in society. As we continue to build capacity in AI through our innovative projects and solutions, as was highlighted, we continue to believe we're moving from good to great. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for those words, Professor Anish. And of course, just a note for all of our delegates this evening, you will all have an opportunity to actually interact with the AI project team. We've got the TUT AI project team, so please do not rush out of here at the end of the lecture, but rather take an opportunity as well and find out exactly some of the innovation that our students have been involved with and as well as our teams have been involved with. And I think that you will not only find it inspiring, but perhaps your next solution to whatever problem that we're facing. We all know our problems, especially when it comes to the South African context. Who knows, maybe the next solution is in this room. So Mayor, I just implore you to take the moment just to have a speak and have a chat and a conversation with the TUT AI project team. Ladies and gentlemen, we've got some more entertainment that is coming in this evening because we've got Professor De Froop, who's from the Faculty of Arts and Design, in his first piece, and the first piece that we're going to be hearing this evening. Professor De Froop will demonstrate how AI was used in its earliest form in music production. He will be playing Johann Sebastian Bach's A in G string with the accompaniment composed using AI algorithms. I'm sure we're definitely in for a treat. We've got Professor De Froop. Thank you so much. It's over to you. Thank you so much, Professor De Vroep. Prof, a very quick one. Now that we understand that we've got the accompaniment that is composed using AI algorithms, just a question for the room, no one in particular. Is AI able to make someone sound like Mariah Carey? It requires a yes or no at this point. And I'm not saying who in particular, I'm just saying if somebody were interested in diversifying careers, would AI help them sound like Mariah Carey? Yes? Yes? Thank you very much. Professor, thank you so much. You have earned your keep. Please give him another round of applause. Ladies and gentlemen, as I did promise that I'm not going to stand between you and some dinner this evening, may I just allow for starters to be served? I do believe that the starters is ready. We're going to give you about 15 or to 20 minutes or so that you're able just to have a feel of the room, do enjoy your starters, and I will come back in the next 20 minutes or so and we'll continue with the program. Is that okay? Thumbs up, everybody? Everybody's okay? Great stuff. Bon appetit, ladies and gentlemen, and I'll see you in the next 20 minutes. jovialism in the tables as I was listening and just passing by the tables. So I'm definitely looking forward to the conversation that is going to be had a little bit later on. And a reminder, please do not be quick to go home. Please take the time to engage with the TUT AI team to find out exactly what have they been up to, especially when it comes to our latest innovation. But host, hostesses, I cannot see you at the back there. Won't you just assist those delegates in taking their seats so that we can begin with the lecture? My promise to you was to make sure that I get you out of here in time for bed. So let's keep to that promise. Those that are still in the foyer, please won't you start making your way back into the auditorium so that we can start with the next part of the program. And then those that are within the auditorium, won't you just start taking your seats so that we can get into the part where we get to hear from the man of the hour. Hostesses, those that are in the foyer, just assist her with the delegates as they make their way inside, please. And those that are in the auditorium, let's just start taking our seats so that we can settle in and get into the next part of the program. All right, let me get a sense or a pulse of the room. How is everybody feeling? I saw that wine was flowing, so everybody should be giving me a thumbs up at this stage. Thumbs up? Everybody's okay? Okay, great stuff. We are really looking forward to the conversation that we're going to have and we're going to deliberate on this evening. Ladies and gentlemen, it is that time where we do get to hear from someone who has really paved the path when it comes to understanding and really navigating the path of artificial intelligence, who's able to explain to us and expound further on this particular phenomenon, especially in how we can implement it within the context of the country, but also of the continent. To help us navigate this very path, please allow me to welcome the Vice Chancellor and the Principal of Tshwane University of Technology, Professor Tinyiko Maluleke, who will be introducing to us the man of the hour, Professor Tshilidzi Marwala. I think we can do better than that. Please do give our Vice Chancellor a round of applause. Thank you so much. Prof.
And I am with how you once again.
Thank you very much. I'll skip the protocols. I think that's why Faith took time to read out everyone's name and go straight to the task that has been given to me. I walked around and I saw how beautiful all of you look. I went to a few tables. On the 1st of January 2004, a new kid on the higher education block was born. That was when the Technikon Northern Gauteng, Technikon Northwest, and Technikon Pretoria were merged to form the Tshwane University of Technology. Taking after its noisy and ambitious erstwhile institutions, the new kid stood out from the crowd. It was loud, it was disagreeable, and it was combative, and it still is. Its student body was made up of the kinds of students who are so hungry for skills and knowledge that they would rather cross rivers, scale mountains, and walk barefoot from village and township until they reach the gates of TUT. There are many ways in which the Tshwane University of Technology could have marked its 20th anniversary. We could have cordoned off a street in Soshanguve, there to dance the night away. We could have marched across the streets of Harankua in our academic regalia with colorful TUT anniversary banners swaying in the wind, with Professor Tshilidzi Marwala leading us in singing the song Ntate Ntekele in the Tshivenda version thereof. We could have marched triumphantly across Roslyn Car Manufacturing Hub towards our Harankua campus. We could have had a bash of the century at the entrance of our Polokwane campus. In other words, We could have retreated into our blue, gold, and red cocoon to reminisce about the good old days and to wallow in our former glory, both real and imagined. But now, we thought better of it. We chose to stay true to our mandate as a maker and originator of knowledge, as an AI hub, at once a center for the future of work and a fountain of entrepreneurship. We decided to turn our anniversary into a moment of intellectual engagement. To this end, we have decided to do something different, something special, with someone different and someone very special, Professor Chilidzi Marwala. In my short life, I've never had the privilege of introducing a scholar on the scale of Chilidzi Marwala in terms of impact, in terms of breadth of knowledge, and sheer brilliance. Please allow me to introduce him briefly. Off the beaten track that connects the towns of Makado and Toyando, beneath a hill so steep it looks like it could tip over, lies the village of Dutuni. The sprawling village sits smack in the middle of the kingdom of Her Majesty Nkosi Wondwamato Ligege. There, in the Lutaba section of the village, Chilidzi Marwala was born to Bo Alpheus Chabani Marwala, who also happens to have been his first maths teacher, Nabo Katuchelo Regina Marwala, his mom. He was inspired and initiated into engineering by his grandmother, Bochianelo, a maker of pots, a knitter of rugs, and a weaver of baskets. As a first grader, young Marwala's classroom at Chibambe Primary School in Dutuni was a large mango tree underneath which he and his fellow pupils were taught by the inimitable Mrs. Nechilema. Marwala's permanently damaged two nails testify to the wear and tear that comes with walking barefoot for years to and from school at the other end of the village. He will remember the early engineering lessons in pottery and farming that his grandmother, Wuchianelo, imparted on him. Prof. Chilidzi Marwala is the current rector of the United Nations University and UN Undersecretary General. He is the former vice chancellor and principal of the University of Johannesburg. He obtained a Bachelor of Science in Mechanical Engineering, magna cum laude, from Case Western Reserve University, USA, in 1995. In 1997, he obtained a Master of Mechanical Engineering degree at the University of Pretoria. After fulfilling all the requirements for the degree, the University of Cambridge awarded Professor Chilidzi Marwala a PhD in Artificial Intelligence and Engineering in the year 2000. He has also completed the Advanced Management Program at Columbia University Business School in 2017 and also a Program for Leadership Development at Harvard Business School in 2007. Between 2003 and 2008, he rose from being an associate professor to becoming a full professor. He also became the incumbent of the Carl and Emily Fuchs Chair of Systems and Control Engineering, as well as the Saatchi Chair of Systems Engineering at the University of Wits. He is a world-renowned expert in artificial intelligence. Prof. Marwala's research interests are nevertheless multidisciplinary. They include the theory and the application of artificial intelligence to engineering, computer science, finance, social science, and medicine. He has an impressive track record in human capacity development. He has supervised 47 masters and 38 doctoral students to completion. Some of these students have completed their doctoral and postdoctoral degrees at leading universities such as Harvard, Oxford, Cambridge, British Columbia, Rutgers, Purdue, Chiba, and Waseda. Professor Marwala has published 27 books on artificial intelligence and related topics. Put your hands together. Don't be shy. One of his books has been translated into Chinese. He has also published over 500 papers in journals, proceedings, book chapters, newspapers, and magazines, and he holds 5 patents. Professor Marwala, Professor Marwala has been a visiting scholar at Harvard University, University of California at Berkeley, at Wolfson College of the University of Cambridge, at Nanjing Technological University, and he is a member of the Programming Council of the Faculty of Electrical Engineering at the Silesian University of Technology in Poland. Professor Marwala is a member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. He is a member of the World Academy of Sciences. He is a member of the Chinese Academy of Sciences. He is a member of the Academy of Science of South Africa. He is a member of the African Academy of Science and the South African Academy of Engineering. He has been a distinguished member of the Association for Computing Machinery. Chilidzi Marwala has received more than 45 awards, including the Order of Mapungu Ubwe, and he was a delegate to the 1989 London International Youth Science Fortnight in high school. His writings and opinions have appeared in The New Scientist, Fortune, The Economist, and Time magazines. In his former capacity as deputy chair of the Presidential Commission on the Fourth Industrial Revolution in South Africa, Professor Marwala has played a key role in shaping the digital future of this country. Marwala is the quintessential academic leader, hailed by his peers across the world for the groundbreaking nature of his research. To conclude, allow me to quote George Bernard Shaw, who on the 28th of October 1930, at a dinner in honor of Albert Einstein in London, introduced Einstein with the following words: "I have said that great men are a mixed lot, but there are orders of great men. There are great men who are great men amongst all men, but there are also great men who are great amongst great men. And that is the sort of a great man you have among you tonight." He was referring to Albert Einstein. I'm referring to this one. And George Bernard Shaw went on to say, "Napoleon and other great men of his time were makers of empire. But there is an order of men who get beyond that. They are not makers of empires, but they are makers of universes. And when they have made those universes, their hands are unstained by the blood of any human being on earth. They are very rare. I go back 2,500 years, and how many of them can I count? I can count them on the fingers of my two hands. Pythagoras, Ptolemy, Aristotle, Copernicus, Kepler, Galileo, Newton, Einstein. And I still have two fingers left vacant, end of quote. Ladies and gentlemen, at this point in my brief presentation, allow me to assist George Bernard Shaw to populate one of his remaining two fingers. Allow me to introduce to you an Einstein of our times. I'm talking of none other than Chilizima Ruara, he who rose from Dutuni to Tokyo via Mbilwi. Hoyu, ndimuduhuru wabochikereme maruara. Hoyu, ndimukaraha wabodokta jabulile manana. Ndowu. Zulani zanu mutava sindi marowa. Ndoukuru ya tengwe. Musinandebe achivona. Iwe mwira na mayandou achishaba usina mano. Iwe mutodandimo asato dishangola mutu. Ndowu. Murimu huru wachimvingi mvingi. Usa kavi gwita. Ndibabulungu butete burunjezwa nga ari na njere. Asi na njere anga faraza. Iwe wa ufulela ndu wodzula. Utakuwa nga ubea suzwa. Ndo kezo.
Thank you very much. Professor Tinyiko Maluleke, you remind me of my grandfather, Wochikereme. If I were to contextualize why my grandfather was called Wochikereme, Wochikereme is a Venda version of an Afrikaans word, skelm. For those of you who understand the word skelm, he was a serious man. Dr. Phumzile Mlambo Ngcuka, my former chancellor when I was at the University of Johannesburg, Dr. Yvonne Chaka Chaka, in 1985, I attended my first festival of music. I remember I went to Twando Stadium at 9 o'clock, and Dr. Yvonne Chaka Chaka only performed at 6 o'clock. But I think my patience was fully rewarded. Deputy Minister Mapulane from the Department of Communication and Digital Technologies, and Ms. Faith Mangope, you continue to inspire us with conversations. And yesterday, I absolutely enjoyed being on your show. And leaders of the university, Tshwane University of Technology, and distinguished guests, including my family members who are here. Before I begin my lecture this evening, I thought it will be an intriguing exercise to see how artificial intelligence would answer the question posed to me this evening, and it is a very difficult question. AI and universities, friends or foes? Mr. Mapulane, this is what we call dialectics. But I went to ChatGPT to help me answer this question. And this is what ChatGPT said, and I quote, "The relationship between AI and universities can be seen as more of a friendship than a rivalry. While there may be some concerns or tensions at times, overall, AI and universities have a symbiotic relationship with many mutual benefits." Close quote. If I were to state that statement, would you be able to tell whether it was said by a human being or a machine? The father of artificial intelligence, Alan Turing, when he wrote the first paper in artificial intelligence in 1950, came up with something called the Turing test. The Turing test basically said that if you interact with a machine and you do not know whether it is a machine or a human being, then that machine is truly intelligent. And for many, many years, we never thought we were going to build machines that will be able to meet that standard of Alan Turing. You would agree with me that today we have built machines that are able to deceive us and confuse us and render us not knowing whether information was generated by a machine or by a human being. 20 years ago, my high school classmate, Alwani Ramaburana, called me at 2 o'clock in the morning. And he says, "Chirizi, do you think you can build an AI system that will be able to predict the lottery number?" That is obviously very entrepreneurial, you know. Well, the answer is actually quite simple. You cannot build an AI system that is able to do that because it is basically a random process, unless it is a biased machine. Having worked at the intersection of education and AI over the last few decades, I think ChatGPT did not completely get the context. I think ChatGPT answer correctly, but a human being might have added a little bit of poetry, as we saw Professor Maluleke introducing me. Of course, AI is here. AI is here because the world has changed. When I entered a PhD program at Cambridge, and by the way, I was at Cambridge with Dr. Oboko, and I was doing AI. I don't know whether Dr. Oboko, you understood what I was studying. I think you thought I was a little bit mad. Most of the algorithms there, and Ben van Veek can actually testify, that we use today were already in place. The perceptron that was discovered maybe in the 40s, 50s, was already perfected in the 80s. Hinton had already written his seminal paper on backpropagation. And neural networks, we call it deep learning now, was already in place. So what has changed? Two things have changed. The first one is that we have more data today than ever before. And the second one is that we have more computation than ever before. When I finished undergraduate degree, I think the computer that we were using was 486. You could not run more than one program at the same time. If you were running WordPerfect, that is what we used to call MS Word then, you know. And you wanted to run Lotus 1-2-3, that's what we call Excel today. You would have to close one program in order to open another. And as when I entered a PhD program, that was during the era of Pentium 1. We were celebrating because we could run two programs at the same time. Today, the world has changed. The world has changed because AI is all around us. But the crucial question that has been asked is whether these AI systems that are all around us are our friend or our enemies. Professor Maluleke, it need not be a binary problem. I think you could have added the third state if I were to use an engineering word, which is both. And I'm going to illustrate this as we move along. But if we were to contextualize AI within the context of higher education, universities, I think the positive impacts, of course, even the negative impacts that this technology brings is actually quite profound. In 2017, my colleague, Professor Bo Xin, who was my PhD student originally from China, and I outlined the implications of the fourth industrial revolution, including AI, on higher education in a research paper. At that time we wrote, and I will quote, though the business of higher education remains unchanged since the times of Aristotle, today's students still assemble at a scheduled time and venue to listen to the wisdom of scholars. That was in 2017. Given the fourth industrial revolution, a new form of a university is emerging that does teaching, research, and service in different manner. The university is interdisciplinary, has virtual classrooms and laboratories, virtual libraries and virtual teachers. It does, however, not degrade educational experience, but augments it, close quote. Indeed, it has been argued by some camps that AI cannot be seen as augmented intelligence. It is so augmented in us physically that I am quite sure that if I were to take a survey here of how many of you reach out to your phones when you wake up, before you even reach out to your loved ones. Because you and that phone has become one. You have married one another. You have become a system, a man or woman machine system. So, for those who question AI space at university, I often go back to the time of COVID. In South Africa, during the COVID time, we deployed AI in multitude of ways. Universities harnessed the power of learning management systems and deployed a variety of technologies through programs such as Blackboard, which had deep data analytics, which enabled emergency remote teaching and learning to continue in the pandemic, with closer attention paid to the progress of individual students. Institutions were able to identify at-risk students and implement targeted interventions to improve retention rates and academic success. This afternoon, I had a conversation with Dr. Mlambo Nuka about this difficult issue that many of our vice chancellors actually do not want to tackle, the issue of student dropout. The people who come to university and never actually complete. What role can AI play for us to be able to deal with at-risk students, improve retention rates, but ultimately improve graduation rates? Of course, during the COVID time, through these technologies, the learning became personalized, and they were developed based on individual student needs and preferences. At University of Johannesburg, we were able to even monitor class attendance and how much time students are actually spending engaging the learning material that were on this platform. We're able to analyze the preferences of students. And of course, the advanced versions of these technologies, aided by face recognition technology, would be able to measure whether the students who are sitting in front of a computer are actually listening, or they are dreaming about a holiday at the Victoria Falls. And of course, these systems can recommend customized learning materials, provide adaptive tutoring that actually looks at the specific needs of students, and suggest personalized study plans. So resource allocations were also optimized through data-driven insights. This was good. Technology was our friend. But we know the problems. Data. As the University of Johannesburg at that time, we were paying almost, I think it was 15 million rand every month on data to send to all the 50,000 students who were studying remotely. And these were not proper data. These were mainly night owls. You see, I come from Limpopo. Whenever you talk about owls, you are normally, I'm not going to continue, but you know what I mean. And it was not just about data. It was also about devices. You will remember when we were moving around trying to send people the devices. And the question that I often analyze is, wouldn't it have been nice if we could use the procurement of these devices as a catalyst, a catalytic instrument for industrialization and entering into the electronic age? And this is the type of thinking that we should always reflect on as we move forward. So, going back to the issue of data, this is what is called the digital divide. The digital divide is actually metamorphosizing into a data divide. And the data divide is actually mutating into inclusion and exclusion. When I was still a vice chancellor of the University of Johannesburg, I visited a country. I almost mentioned the name of a country. Oh, thank God. Because the last time I mentioned the name of the country, the ambassador came and camped into my office. And I was not even a diplomat then, you know. So it was me, Wongani Nolunga, Oscar van Heersden, and Peter Vail. When you arrive at this country, you take your passport and put it on a machine. And then the machine looks at the picture on your passport and it looks at your face and basically validate that the person that is on the passport is the person I am seeing now. Once it does that, the gate opens. Masango avulile. And as a vice chancellor, I gave a specific instruction that I should be the first one to pass through, you know. Big mistake. So as I put my passport, high corner, it could not verify. Comes Peter Vail. It opened so fast. Then comes Wongani Nolunga, icon. Then came Oscar van Heersden. Yeah, it opened fast. These systems are discriminating against people of African descent. Well, the South African tradition is to organize a march. I don't know how we can organize a march to a deep learning neural network. Ben van Wyk, you can assist me on that one, you know. The reason for that is because the data that was used to train was not complete. It was not complete because the world is divided into data rich and data poor countries. And it did not work because there was not much data that was gathered from Mahlabathini, where Wongani comes from, or Dutuni, where I come from. Then, of course, engineers say, no. We can synthesize data. Synthetic data is actually the solution that people are actually talking about. That wherever we do not measure, if we don't go to Mahlabathini, at least we can get Wongani picture, and from it we generate a million more. Of course, for those of you who understand statistics, you have a sampling problem. And of course, these systems go into more than face recognition. They go into medical diagnosis, and so on and so forth. As the United Nations, we are very worried about the issue of a digital divide. And as a result, going to the Summit of the Future, Dr. Phumzile Mlambo-Ngcuka, now I can speak the language. And we are going to go there with the digital, global digital compact, which will address some of the issues that needs to be addressed when it comes to issues of access, so that we can make AI our friend, not our foe. And of course, it is more than just data. It's about access to certain types of IPs that we require. So we are here, and generative AI is here. Now, there are a number of issues that we need to reflect upon when it comes to generative AI. It obviously has the capacity to generate new content, such as images, text, or music, based on the patterns and data it has been trained on. But some of the contents are bad, while some of them are good. I'll give you an example. It can be able to create an image of a person. Now, if that person is a pious priest of a church, and then you can be able to create him smoking some drugs. Fake image. You will agree with me that is not good. That fake image is bad because it is intended to undermine another human being. I went to a medical school, I visited a medical school, and they were telling me that we actually love these fake images. I said, what do you mean? It says, when we used to teach anatomy, we will get these models that will have to be photographed because the photographs are not necessarily nice photographs from human dignity perspective. We'll cover their faces. Now, with fake images like that, that are realistic, there is no need to cover anybody's image because that person actually has never existed. It's a fake image. Now, these generative AI are now able to write essays. The question that I would like to ask is that given that many of the things that we use to teach people to be able to do, these machines are able to do, what is the role of a university? Professor Maluleke, given these very important issues that I have just outlined, what is your value proposition? Of course, the value proposition is there. It means we need to move up into a much more creative spaces. We need to treat these technologies just like we treat a calculator. There was a time before the Japanese company called Casio brought calculators to our villages, when I was not yet in high school, people were using three-figure tables. Those who are old enough will know what I'm talking about. You know, and the and many people were, there were even protests of people in the United States saying that calculators must be banned because they are making people intellectually lazy. You know, the slide rule and the three-figure tables or four-figure tables are good enough. Of course, we know calculators allowed us to teach much more complicated things, and they have been good for us. I think this is what we need to do. But of course, we are teaching today when these technologies are not yet properly regulated. According to a survey conducted by the U.S. in the U.S. by the best colleges, it found that 56 of students admitted to using AI for assignments. And the answer that was given was to say, no, we are going to do a check to see whether you use ChatGPT or not. Then the engineer says, no, we are going to create another system. There's some other system called QuillBot. You put a paragraph and you decide whether you want to make it formal or you want to make it academic, or you want to make it simple, or you want to shorten it, or you want to expand it, and you just press a button, it does exactly that. Now, what is the role of a university in a context like that? So I went to ChatGPT, and I said, mirror, mirror on the wall. Professor Maluleke, I'm not about to sing. Who is Chirizima Rwara? And then it started writing a story. And I could pick up that certain things were not correct. It says, I studied at the University of the Witwatersrand. I worked at the University of Witwatersrand. It says that I studied at the University of Johannesburg. I worked at the University of Johannesburg. And by the way, it is being smart. It can detect that I'm associated with University of Johannesburg and University of the Witwatersrand. And statistically, the university that you are associated with on the internet is actually the university where you studied, not the university where you work, because there's simply too few people who work at universities. That is statistics 101. Go and learn. So, now, I started reflecting. I mean, this is simple information. Imagine if you are asking it about a medical condition. That will require a doctor to verify whether these facts are correct. I think as these technologies come into fruition, the ability to verify becomes very important, because these technologies can lie with a straight face. They can lie with a straight face. Because even though they distill everything on the internet through their filter and generate as much text as possible and dump it to the reader, our flawed and beautiful minds, by contrast, can be able to, if it is trained well, can be able to discern that actually he only worked at University of Johannesburg, not studied there. Currently, I mean, this is true. Currently, the only form of verification is actually Wikipedia. If you are not on Wikipedia, good luck. Your mirror, mirror on the wall will probably always bring information that is not correct. So there are many other examples where AI is useful. issues of virtual labs. I'm an engineer. One of the most difficult things about training engineers is that it is expensive. With virtual labs, we can simulate real-world experiences, experiments, and practical exercises, allowing students to gain hands-on experience remotely. And these labs can augment learning experience and provide accessible, flexible, and safe and cost-effective opportunities for students to engage hands-on experimentation and practical experiences. Going forward, what is to be done? I think firstly, we need to design an AI system so that it is able to maximize the good things that come out of this technology, making it our friend, and minimize the bad things that come out of this technology, it being a fool. And how do we do that? I think the first thing that we need to do is to establish the values that should define AI. What are some of these values that define AI? I think firstly, it must be accurate. And quite frankly, we have not discovered a technology of measuring the accuracy of an essay. You know. Secondly, AI must be accessible. And access means every student who passes through your educational institution must actually have knowledge of AI. When I was a vice chancellor of the University of Johannesburg, I introduced the compulsory AI course for all the students. It was a literacy course. And this is done so that AI access to it, which has become a human rights issue, is embedded on graduates. I think the another value that we really have to take seriously, and this is a difficult one, transparency. AI is able to generate information. How it generates is actually a mystery, especially if you are using complicated multi-layer perceptrons. With many, many inputs, because there is a cross-coupling that you cannot be able to eliminate. I think this AI must be non-discriminatory. In other words, Wongani and Chiridzi, when they visit that country, must not be prevented because they have African faces. And of course, when we talk about all these values, we realize very, very quickly that engineers will not be able to do this on their own. We require people who have studied ethics. We actually require multidisciplinary education. And the value of multidisciplinary education cannot be emphasized enough. I have a theory. Because for a long time, I always wondered why Germany does not have their own Facebook or their own Twitter and so on and so forth. And I came to the conclusion that the reason is because their educational experience is not multidisciplinary. If you contrast that with what is happening in Silicon Valley, American education system actually is absolutely very multidisciplinary. When I was a mechanical engineering student in Ohio, I actually took 12, I was required to take 12 human and social sciences. I took 3 acting classes. So if I go for audition in 7 Dilan, I'm in. I even participated in a play called My Children, My Africa, as Tamim Bikwana. For those of you who have read it. Took psychology classes. I was very, very excited. I think I was on that stand where they were talking about the use of reinforcement learning. He's there. You should go and find out. It's an algorithm. But I did not learn about reinforcement learning from an engineering class. I actually learned it from a psychology class. It starts with Pavlov and his dogs and the theory of conditioning, and it ends with the theory of reinforcement learning. And I think taking it, that concept from engineering and computer science, no, from psychology to engineering and computer science, is actually detail. It's not much innovation, it's detail, because the algorithm is there in the natural world. The second thing that I think we need to do is to change human behavior. We need to change human behavior of people who are designing these algorithms. We need to change human behavior of people who are using these algorithms. Because some people are using these algorithms for sinister reasons. And that is not good. Which means our curriculum must actually address that issue. Responsible use of technology, not just AI, responsible use of AI, of technologies. And some of these behaviors graduate into national levels and manifest themselves in the weaponization of technologies, ending us with what you were talking, when you were talking about Mr. Shaw, man with hands dripping in blood, aided by technology. Very important. I think at another level, we need to design mechanisms. One of my former PhD students here, Dr. Maumera, did a master's in Japan on mechanism design. We need to have incentives that incentivize people to do the right things. And they do the right things beginning in the classroom, all the way to the rest of the world. But at the same time, we need to design these incentives so that people cannot do bad things. Then we need to create structures. How do we regulate this technology? Some of the regulations will have to happen at the national level. Some of them will have to happen at the continental level. The AU is actually dealing with the issue of regulation of AI. The EU is dealing with the issue of regulation of AI. And some of this should happen at the international level. The United Nations has a high-level advisory board on AI that will deal with the ethics of AI. So these are important things. And then on top of that, we need to develop standards. And the standards of AI are very, very complicated. Because accuracy in one area, which is very good, is bad in another area. For example, an accuracy of 95% in a medical diagnostic system is good, because a human doctor cannot achieve those levels of accuracy. But the same accuracy requirement for an aircraft is bad. It means that of the 100 flights that are going to happen, roughly 5 are going to come down. So it has to be done also at specific industries have to have their own standards. Some of them will be done at national, regional, and international. Standardization is quite important. And ultimately, we need to create laws to govern this. And DM Mapulane, it means our lawmakers must become technologically literate. Technological literacy, illiteracy in our lawmakers is a very dangerous attribute. It means universities must create spaces to be able to inform and educate our lawmakers about the developments that are happening around AI, which are happening as we speak. I know I've been speaking for a long time, but now I am coming to an end. What are the elements that we need to govern? I have talked about these systems, human behavior, mechanisms. I have talked about structures, policies and regulations, standards and law. But what are we regulating? What should we regulate? I think we need to regulate data. I think we need to regulate algorithms. I think we need to regulate computing. Universities of today must have access to high-performance computing. I think we need to regulate applications that come out of this. Now, coming to the end of my talk, I read an insightful article in the New York Times, and I'm going to quote what it says. AI will force us humans to double down on those talents and skills that only humans possess. The most important thing about AI may be that it shows us what it can't do, and so reveals who we are and what we have to offer. Now I'm going to extend, and we teach those things that we have to offer. In conclusion, and answering the question of friend versus foe, I'm reminded of Charles Dickens when he explained the optimism and disappointment of the French Revolution in A Tale of Two Cities. And of course, I know we have a representative from the French embassy. And there is a valid criticism of Charles Dickens, especially his book on A Tale of Two Cities. They say he couldn't have written A Tale of Two Cities because he only lived in one, which was London. So I'm going to quote Dickens. It was the best of times. It was the worst of times. It was the age of wisdom. It was the age of foolishness. It was the epoch of belief. It was the epoch of incredulity. It was the season of light. It was the season of darkness. It was the spring of hope. It was a winter of despair. We had everything before us. We had nothing before us. We were all going directly to heaven. We were all going directly the other way. And of course, this is really what AI is all about. It is ushering the best of times, but at the same time, it is ushering the worst of times. The divides, the discriminations of AI system, generating fake information to disrupt people and society. Its positive impact as our friend on health, economy, and education is absolutely impressive. However, its negative elements as a foe, and I talked about fake news, militarization of AI, the undermining of human rights using AI, are causes for concern. We have to ensure that AI is used to maximize the good and minimize the bad. We need to develop all these values to be able to deal with this technology. We need to understand the aspects of AI that needs to be regulated. And of course, if we dare fail, and those who ignore AI, I think they shall fail. Universities that ignore AI or treat it as a technological subject, they are going to fail. And those who embrace it in all their disciplines are going to succeed. Thank you very much. Ndiyalibuwa, ngiyabonga, kiyalibuya. Baya danke.
Recibiseng mapar. Risiki manyana le mapara Redevese ne ba chelede Risiki manyana ba chelede Varitise nyama lenga nyama champagne Varitise nyama lenga nyama champagne Varipacha nyama lenga nyama champagne Varipacha nyama lenga nyama champagne Ai manere nyaka rufo
Thank you very much. This is the 20th anniversary of TUT. I think it's a special moment. And I congratulate this great university. May its successes multiply. As a sign of appreciation of the positive work it is playing, co-host of South Africa's AI Hub, I have decided to install to the Vice Chancellor the SDG pin. As the United Nations, we have 17 goals that have to be achieved by 2030. As of last year, we only met 15% of the goals. The rest, we are either tracking behind or we are worse than we were in 2015 when we adopted them. Climate action cannot wait. So all the beautiful things that you are doing here, health, actually advance sustainable development. Goal number four, good health and well-being. The education that you are giving is SDG 3. The issue of gender equality, and I say this because our former executive director of UN Women is here. I have to congratulate her for bringing activism to this very important issue. The issue of peace and security. You can't have progress without peace and security. They are all embedded on these 17 goals. So it is indeed my honor to install this prestigious SDG on you, and congratulating Tshwane University of Technology for a successful 20 years. And I wish Tshwane University of Technology a successful next 200 years. Thank you very much.
I think it is quite fitting after a presentation that was given by Professor Marwala for us in the room to say, wow. Wow. And I think more than anything else, Prof, what we took away, and I actually wrote it down, because if you have to summarize and bring context to the insights that you were sharing, and I wrote it down and I said, actually, what you presented was that AI forces us to think about thinking. So we don't just educate, but rather we think about why we educate, so that we think about what to educate. And perhaps that is a challenge upon all of us, that maybe artificial intelligence, as it encapsulates all of us, and it is here, forces us to think a bit deeper, a bit more laterally, and a bit more creatively about the world, about the continent, and perhaps about the state that we would like to build. And with that, we really do thank you for your insights. We thank you for that lecture. I know that beyond it being insightful, I think it was a challenge to all of us to really understand and deep dive into the intricacies of artificial intelligence and the role that it plays with or without our permission in this day and age. So with that, thank you so much. Won't you all give Professor Marwala another round of applause, please? I think we've all been forced to think about thinking. Ladies and gentlemen, it is time to welcome back my new best friend, because of what he can do with music, Professor De Vroep, onto the podium, to provide with us his second piece, which will demonstrate how AI is currently used for composition and music production. He will be playing Ain't Nobody by Chaka Khan. And Prof, just a very quick one, asking for a friend again. The AI is able to make a person sound like Chaka Khan, correct? Even if they don't have the voice. Asking, yes? Take it away, Professor. Asking for a friend. Thank you so much. Do enjoy, Professor De Vroep. Thank you very much, Professor De Froop, there just giving us another piece, which will obviously demonstrating our AI is actually being used in composition and music production as well. Much appreciated for it. Really much thanks. Ladies and gentlemen, we have reached close to the end of formalities, but this does not mean that you hurry on home. It means that you will then have dinner, which is served. Please do take time. As I said, we've got our exhibition, which will allow us just to get a clearer understanding in terms of the work that has been done by the AI team at the Tshwane University of Technology. So please do not hurry on home, as, of course, the night is still young, but I have to make sure that you are fed. So therefore, to give the vote of thanks this evening, it is my absolute honor and my privilege to call upon to the stage now the Deputy Vice Chancellor of Research, Innovation and Engagement, Dr. Vaiti Papu Zamkhaka, the Deputy Vice Chancellor of Research, Innovation and Engagement, to do the vote of thanks. Please give a round of applause as she makes her way to the front. Thank you so much, Doc.
Keep telling me. Sanbonang, Dumelang, Molweni Bethun, Goeienag, Absheng. Good evening. The Chancellor of our university, the Tshwane University of Technology, Dr. Gloria Serobe, the former Chancellor of our institution who had just left, Dr. Phumzile Mlambo-Ngcuka, the Chairman of our Council, Advocate Ivan Kambonani, the Council members, sorry, give me a sec. Advocate Ivan Kambonani, the council members among us, the vice chancellor and the principal of our institution, the visionary leader, Professor Tinyiko Maluleke, the United Nations University Rector, Professor Chilidzi Marwala, the Chancellor of the University of KwaZulu-Natal, Dr. Rual Khoza, government representatives, the Deputy Minister of Communications and Digital Technologies, Honorable Fili Mapulane, the Deputy Minister of Finance, Honorable Dr. David Masondo, the Director General of the Department of Higher Education and Training, Dr. Nkosinathi Sishi, the Deputy Director General of the Department of Science and Innovation, Dr. Mboneni Mofe, the Group Executive for Business Advancement at the National Research Foundation, who is also my predecessor, Dr. Thandi Mgwebi. The CEOs of government entities who are in our midst, the honorary doctorate holder, my big sis, Alcivon Chaka Chaka, Dr. Minga. Representatives from the embassies, the South African ambassador to Belgium, who is joining us online tonight, Her Excellency Ms. Thokozile Xhasa, the ambassador of Turkey to South Africa, Her Excellency Asiko Kandas. The representatives also from the embassy of Finland, from the French embassy, Mr. Orlen Leyant, the attaché for science and academic cooperation, Mr. Gerben Klein Leben, representing the Netherlands embassy in South Africa, Dr. Yan Li, first secretary from the Chinese embassy, together with a number of representatives as well from the Chinese embassy, and Mr. Vichula Makananise from the British High Commission. Colleagues from the education fraternity, TUT members of the executive management, TUT colleagues, the sister university colleagues, higher education and science councils, student representatives, various government representatives, civil society organization represented here today, business and industry colleagues, our distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. Program Director, I stand here as a very proud staff member of the Tshwane University of Technology, whom on behalf of this institution wishes to take this opportunity to express our sincere gratitude to all of you who are here and those who have joined us through various social media platforms. Your being here with us this evening as we celebrate this milestone, which marks another important chapter in the anthropology of the evolution of the university. It is heartwarming. Looking at the diversity of the delegation here, from government, from industry, from science councils, from sister universities, both in South Africa and abroad, British High Commission, including the ambassadors from different countries, shows appreciation of the fact that traditional images of universities as self-contained autonomous institutions are being displaced by the growing numbers of them working in multiple partnerships with external organizations, both in government and in industry, to solve societal challenges. I am making these remarks not to give a speech, but as a way of giving meaning to what I have been requested to do this evening, which is simply to give a vote of thanks. However, the simplicity of this task lies in its complexity. I mean, how do I single out each one of you who all came to honor our event, because to us your presence is equally important. Thank you so much to the ambassadors who are here, the CEOs of companies and government officials and everyone. Now, I would like to thank very much so on behalf of our institution, Professor Tshilidzi Marwala, the Rector for United Nations University, for your keynote address, which resonated with what we should all be preoccupied with in our imaginative ingenuity as we contemplate the future. Your speech tonight was so eye-opening, was so insightful, was so thought-provoking. And I stand in here pledging that as a Tshwane University of Technology, we shall respond accordingly to the call of action that we have made. I would like to also extend our gratitude to our newly appointed Chancellor, Dr. Gloria Serobe. Siyabulela mama, we have no shadow of doubt that the future is bright with you on board. Gratitude is also extended to the Council of the Tshwane University of Technology, led by our chairperson, Mr. Ivan Gambonani. Thank you, Mr. Chair, for always supporting university initiatives. To our visionary leader, our Vice Chancellor and the Principal, Professor Tinyiko Maluleke, for his outstanding leadership. I thought you would clap hands for that. For his outstanding leadership and for always encouraging us to strive for excellence and to do the best we can to move this beautiful university from good to great. VC, I think now it is time to even talk about the movement of the university from great to awesomeness. Those who have eyes have seen. You have steered the ship to a right direction. And for that, as the members of this institution, we are truly grateful. Abanamehlo bayabona. Then those who are blind, unfortunately, will remain blind. Ladies and gentlemen, today marks a special occasion as we gather to celebrate two decades of empowering people. As a university of technology, we have accepted our responsibility to conduct research, engage with communities, and provide effective teaching and learning opportunities that align with the developmental goals set forth by our government's National Development Plan 2030, the African Union Agenda 2063, and of course, the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals that Professor Marola was talking about just a few minutes ago. As we reflect on our achievements since 2004, we remain focused on our ultimate objective of driving progress and development in society. We are grateful for the partnership and support we have received over the past 20 years, and we look forward to continuing to develop effective connections between universities, government, civil society, business, and industry. And of course, that would mean that we have responded to the quadruple helix. It is with your support, ladies and gentlemen, that the Tshwane University of Technology can move from good to great. As we strive to find solutions to today's and future challenges, to produce future-ready graduates, and to make knowledge work, we would appreciate your company on this journey. That's a call of action. As it has been pointed out, as a university which is home to AI Hub, which is home to the Institute for Future of Work, the university that co-hosts the Cannabis Hub, the university that drives the renewable energy research and innovation strategy, to name but a few, we extend our invitation to you all to come and work with us. The future we want is within reach only through partnerships or through collaborations. In other words, as the future becomes, the sanctuary of our insula is increasingly becoming unattainable. As the late State President Tata Nelson Rolihlahla Mandela once stated, I open quote, education is the most powerful weapon which you can use to change the world, close quote. It fills our hearts with warmth and hope to witness the gathering of esteemed representatives from government, civil society, the international community, academia, and industry in celebrating of the people's or celebration of the people's university, the Tshwane University of Technology. As I draw closer to an end, as TUT, we would like to express our deepest gratitude to you for joining us in celebrating this momentous occasion. And we extend our sincerest well wishes for all your future endeavors. Before I sit down, I would have made the very biggest mistake if I do not express the sincerest gratitude to the organizing committee that has worked tirelessly to ensure that we have this day today. I'm not going to call them by names, but I'm talking about men and women who sacrificed the public holiday on the 21st of March. Men and women who worked throughout the Easter holiday. Please can you stand so that we can recognize you. I do not even know how to express the gratitude that is in our hearts. As a Deputy Vice Chancellor that worked very closely with you, I am speechless. I am truly humbled by your selfless dedication to the work of this institution. I must also mention that even though not all of them were part of the organizing committee, but the task team for AI Hub that this institution has is playing a remarkable role. And I hope and pray that after the talk by Professor Marwala, we won't be only be focusing on the projects that we have showcased today, but we'll also make a change to the institution itself, how it operates through AI, because AI needs to be seen in everything that we do. It needs to be integrated in everything that we do. So with those words, I thank you very much. To the Acting Executive Director, whom we seldom single out, who is having so many hurts, Professor Anish Kurien, when you responded to the call that we have made with the VC, you never said, I have got too much on my plate. You've handled this work with so much determination, and we are truly grateful. We are truly, truly grateful. Sithike kuni nonke, maze nethole, amaqobokazana ngalale ndleleni ngabe kunyembelekile.
Thank you so much, Deputy Vice Chancellor. Ladies and gentlemen, let me bring you the good news for this evening, because it is my absolute honor and my absolute privilege to do so. We are done with the formalities, which means that we can now feed you. So thank you so much for really bearing with us with the program. I know that we began a little bit late, but we managed to catch things up. It is with this that we bring the formalities for this evening to a close. As said, though, this is the time that we open up for dinner. And let me take this opportunity just to let you know how dinner is going to work so that everybody is well abreast with it. What is going to happen is that you're all going to be instructed, you're going to be leaving per row. So let's say tables 1 to 5. You would first get up. You just go through the foyer right by the lake where you had your canapes before you came into the auditorium. That's where you will have a buffet-style dinner that will be served. So tables 1 to 5. From 5, then we're going to go from tables 6 to 10, 10 to 15, and so on and so forth. I think would be also wise, we will be also assisting you, just guiding you along the tables as well as you make your way to get dinner. Do not worry, don't fret. There's enough food for everybody, a little birdie told me. So if there's not food, please do come back and just let us know. It has been an absolute honor and an absolute privilege to be with you this evening to really listen to the innovation that is being demonstrated through the work of Tshwane University of Technology. And I echo with what Professor Marwala was saying a little bit earlier on. Though we may be celebrating your 20th anniversary this evening, I do know that we will be celebrating your 200th anniversary because of visionaries that you have. So more than anything else, it is a congratulations to the Tshwane University of Technology. You have not only proven yourself to be relevant, but you've proven yourself to be wise. Here's to the generations that will be educated from this institution. Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen. As I said, don't hurry on home. We've got lots of music, we've got lots of dancing, and we've also got lots of drinks as well. I promised that I was going to get you out of here on time, and I'm doing just that. It has been an absolute honor to serve you. My name is Faith Mangope. Have a fantastic rest of your evening, and do enjoy dinner. Bon appetit.
Two decades ago, far rose a vision so clear, the beacon of knowledge, year after year, from humble beginnings to greatness. It's our fate.
TUT, where good times are great. We're celebrating 20 years. Tshwane stands tall. Empowering minds, breaking
how it goes.